pleasure to welcome to Sri Lanka Mr. George Dilama, President of Eisenhower Fellowships. George is visiting Sri Lanka for the first time, son of Cuban immigrants, grown up in the United States, started as a reporter at the Chicago Tribune, went on to become the managing director of its multiple Pulitzer winning editorial team, news team. Subsequently worked in the Inter-American Development Bank, and after that had done consulting and other work with global entities, started his own enterprise also, I believe, and now leads the Eisenhower Fellowship, which is something that was started on the birthday in 1953 of President Dwight D. Eisenhower. And I'll ask George to explain to us. People in Sri Lanka don't necessarily know who these Eisenhower Fellows are. What the Eisenhower Fellowship is all about. So once again, we welcome you, George, to Colombo. My first sort of question to you is, what's your first impression of this city? You've been here less than 12 hours.
Yes. Well, first of all, Harsha, thank you very much. It's a pleasure and an honor to be here in Sri Lanka. It's a nation that I've wanted to visit for many, many years. You're right, I'm a recovering journalist. And when I worked at the Chicago Tribune, I was a correspondent, and later I was an editor. And many of my colleagues were here, and they covered some of the darkest years of the conflict here in Sri Lanka. And I know from the experiences that they shared with me, despite the difficulties, and it was a dangerous time for them, they really fell in love with the people here, and I can see that. So my first impression here is not just the climate, but the very warm reception that my wife Carrie and I, she's a filmmaker from the United States, and we just got in late last night, and we've had a very warm welcome since we've been here, and we're delighted to be here.
Now, George, what is Eisenhower Fellowship, and what is its purpose? Why does it exist, and what are you trying to do? Is it some American political machine, or is it what is it?
Well, not at all. I'm glad you asked. Eisenhower Fellowships is an independent, nonpartisan, non-governmental nonprofit. It's one of the world's premier international leadership organizations. Eisenhower Fellowships, you're right, it was a birthday present to President Eisenhower his first year in the White House from four friends of his in Philadelphia. And President Eisenhower, in World War II, he was the supreme Allied commander of all Allied troops in Europe. And really the military leader who oversaw the successful prosecution of the war in Europe against Nazi Germany. When he returned after the war, President Eisenhower, at that time General Eisenhower, he wrote and said publicly he was a soldier who had seen too much of war, and he wanted to dedicate his life to public service to trying to bring about peace. So the mission of the organization was in 1953, very much as it is today, 65 years later, to enhance international understanding and to create a world that's more peaceful, prosperous, and just. So what we do is we identify and recruit and bring to the United States outstanding mid-career leaders between age 32 and 45. Many of them have been from here in Sri Lanka, including yourself. And we bring them to the United States for individualized seven-week fellowships. And they're from all sectors, government, business, civil society, science, education, the arts. We even take journalists. And so if you're, say, an urban planner, you come to the United States for 7 weeks, You go to 8, 9, 10, some have gone to 12 American cities, and you meet with 60, 70, 80 of the top people in your field. And one of the things that we require as a result, at the end of this experience, it's a transformational experience to really challenge our fellows to grow professionally and personally. But also one of the new things in the organization in the last 3 years or so, we have instituted a new requirement that you have to have a concrete project with a real world impact, so that when you return to your country, we can maximize the impact of our fellows. And then with that, we've also added the requirement, because it's very important to many of us there, that our fellows mentor younger leaders behind them, which is another way to extend the impact.
Yeah, I mean, let me share with you, because I was 2010 Global Fellow, batch of, I think, about 25. But as I was about to embark on this 7-week program, I was brought into Parliament on the national list soon after the April election. So therefore, I was allowed to push it back a year. So I ended up going in 2011. So my class of 2011 comes from various fields, from various countries. I have friends from Brazil to Palestine, to Israel, to Australia, to India, to Spain, to the Philippines, and Indonesia. And the great thing is, we are on a WhatsApp group. On a sort of a daily basis, you know, we follow, and each individual is doing something fascinating, you know. And that friendships that we built in that 7 weeks, first in Philadelphia, then the program is such that, like George said, you get to pick your schedule. You know, you define what you want to do based on your interests. So for me, I was a lot of time I was in Washington, D.C., New York City. Then I was, traveled to the West Coast. I was in San Francisco, you know, in Silicon Valley, places like that. And I was trying to understand how political economic thought was sort of being discussed, and how American, the political system was sort of on the ground being implemented, and how it was criticized and reported. Met with senior politicians, you know, and then sort of spend time together once again with all the entire group that great weekend at the Grand Canyon, and then again meeting back in Philly to sort of finish up the leadership program. For me, certainly it was a transformational program, because I never would have been able to meet the kind of people who I met, you know, very senior people. And for others, I hear I was similar. Now, that is just my personal experience. When you say you are looking for, you know, peace, prosperity, justice, right? You know, that, how do you get that, you know, these three things that you want to achieve? How do you spread that? How do you bring a person from, say, Sri Lanka or Australia?
So it sounds like you've had the authentic experience that many fellows have had. After this is our 65th year, and one of the great achievements of the organization, it's had very distinguished chairmen. Our chairman now is General Colin Powell, who was Secretary of State in the United States. His predecessor was Secretary of State Henry Kissinger. Before him, we had President George Herbert Walker Bush as the chairman of the board. Before him, President Gerald Ford. So it's a very prestigious organization with a very prestigious board of trustees. Again, independent, nonpartisan. It's not tied to the government or to any party. But after 65 years, we've had almost 2,400 fellows since then, around 1,900 of whom are still alive. And what's left is this amazingly influential global network of leaders. So right now, over the last few years, our network has included the current governor of the central bank in Thailand, the former finance minister, now minister of planning and economic development of Indonesia, vice minister of education in China, editor of the top newspaper in Turkey, the former governor of the Saudi Arabian General Investment Authority, all of our dynamic fellows, yourself and others who are leaders in industry and government here in Sri Lanka. And this network around the world, one of the things that we really do is we try to promote collaboration between our fellows within the countries. We've worked in more than 110 countries since the organization was founded. Right now we're active in about 56. So we as we try to promote collaboration among the fellows in Sri Lanka or in India or in Pakistan, we also work to promote collaboration between fellows from different countries. So how do we promote this? How do we try to create this world? What we provide is a forum. We connect leaders, like-minded leaders who are intent on bettering our world. And we build bridges. We build bridges across borders and across cultures. And we tear down the walls that divide us. And that's what Eisenhower Fellowships, that's what we do, and that's who we are. In concrete terms, we have fellows working in different countries who are collaborating on projects with real impact. I just came from Indonesia earlier in the week. And in Indonesia, where one of our fellows is a senior minister, he is collaborating with one of our Eisenhower Fellows from Spain, who is a globally noted urban planner, to help create 10 new Balis for sustainable ecotourism in Indonesia that will really advance their economic and social development in the country. And it's a project that came together with two Eisenhower Fellows and a conversation that originated at a conference we just had in Malaga last September. And there's just one example. In Ireland, we had Eisenhower Fellows back in 1989 from Northern Ireland and from the Republic, who were all put together in one class of fellows, and they didn't know each other. There was a lot of mistrust, but they spent, at that time the program was longer, 3 months. They spent 3 months together. When they went back to Ireland, they've continued, like your class of fellows, continued these liaisons, and they would meet twice a year. A few years later, the two governments are negotiating the Good Friday Peace Accords that brought peace to Northern Ireland. We had one Eisenhower Fellow was the Chief of Staff to the leader of Northern Ireland. Another one was Chief of Staff to the Prime Minister of the Republic of Ireland. They literally sat across from the table from each other and helped negotiate this peace after building a relationship of trust. So we have a really concrete impact. Our fellows here in Sri Lanka, you know them very well. They are from all fields. They have built hospitals. They bring clean water to rural areas. They work to advance the empowerment of women. They work in reconciliation after the conflict that was here. And you magnify that by the 50 countries where we work. That's what we do. And there's one thing I didn't mention that's very important, because I came in, I just joined the organization 3.5 years ago. I came in really advocating that in this day and age, it's as important or more for Americans to know about the rest of the world than for international leaders to know about us. Yeah. And so one thing that strategically we've embarked on is a concerted effort to grow. We have a U.S. program that sends American leaders overseas. Some of them have come here to visit Sri Lanka. And we've doubled the size of that, and we want to keep continuing to grow that, because those exchanges are enriching for both sides.
I mean, there's no doubt this is an awesome program. And now I recall when I got selected, you know, there's a whole lot of equally good people. And there's several rounds of interviews by eminent personalities. And one person got picked as a fellow in what is called a global program. Then there are other programs, women's program, then there are regional programs where some folks from a particular region would go across to the U.S. for 7 weeks and so on. Now, George, I mean, I'm sure, given the opportunity, many people in this country would like to become this Eisenhower Fellow, because it's a 7-week program. You don't have, this is not like taking 9 months. and going and sitting in some college classroom. This is not. Right? This is ideal for, like you said, emerging leaders, you know, in the age bracket of 32 to 45. How does one become an Eisenhower Fellow?
Well, you can apply directly to our organization. We're based in Philadelphia in the States through our website, which is www.efworld.org. And then in Sri Lanka, as in all the other countries where we operate, we have a nominating committee of distinguished leaders, some Eisenhower Fellows and some not, who recruit, interview, and then nominate to Philadelphia outstanding candidates. So you're absolutely right. This fall, for instance, last fall, we had a program that was all fellows from the Middle East and South Asia. So we had fellows from Pakistan, India, Sri Lanka, for the first time in our history, Myanmar, and from 8 countries in the Middle East, all together in one program. The year before, we had a program in the fall that was just fellows from sub-Saharan Africa, from that region. The year before, a women's leadership program, where one of the fellows was from here, from Sri Lanka. This fall, we're very excited. We're going to have a program, an innovation program, that's going to be focused on 5 sectors of innovation: the future of work and artificial intelligence and all the new developments there, the related field of innovation and education. The third one is health and life sciences, which is exploding with possibilities right now. The fourth one is energy and the environment. And the fifth field is design, in the design of new systems, which is the 21st century field that ties all these together. And the reason we're having 5 sectors, there'll be 25 fellows. That means there'll be 5 in each of these areas. And when they're done with the program, that creates a ready-made sub-cohort of fellows from around the world that they can collaborate with on programs. The deadline, we're going to extend it a little bit, so any outstanding between 32 and 45 leaders who have a record of leadership and the potential to do much more, if you are interested in this, we would welcome you to apply for this.
Yeah, because the opportunity is, like I said, awesome, because you get to go meet perhaps the best in the business. And I mean, I was in Boston, you know, and looking at some of the innovations, you know, related to what I call economic freedom and how that was being applied and practiced. For those who are interested in innovation, for instance, you know, you can, through the fellowship, through the program, make appointments and go and meet CEOs of, you know, the top companies in the world. So it's an opportunity, I think, if at all possible, should never be missed. There is intense competition, but one can try. Now, moving back to sort of trying to see this great concept, whether it can be applied, say, for instance, in Sri Lanka. Some of the new fellows have been telling us that we should perhaps think about bringing folks from different parts of this country, you know, and bring them to perhaps Colombo and, you know, let them meet with their, you know, idols or folks that they would die to meet, and then create sort of a localized Eisenhower type program. Have you seen things like that getting spun off in other countries? Or
we have actually in India, right next door, because it's such a big country. In India, our fellows are really geographically dispersed, and they're not just in, say, Mumbai and Delhi or Bangalore. We have them there too, but they're all over the country, so we've seen that. And in a country like Sri Lanka, as you mentioned, I'm of Cuban descent. Cubans love boxing. In a boxing metaphor, Sri Lanka punches above its weight, because for a small country, the group of fellows here is so dynamic and so engaged. And that's part of the reason that I'm here, to meet with you and with them. We would welcome fellows. We'd like to expand our work here, actually, and we would welcome fellows from all over the country. One of the things that the Sri Lankan fellows have been central to, and another concrete example of impact, last year, we had a dynamic regional conference about South Asia Rising and the connectivity economically and socially within the countries of this region. And it was organized really by fellows from Pakistan and India, with a lot of involvement from fellows from Sri Lanka. Your deputy foreign minister was there and others. And we held it in Dubai. And it was wildly successful. It was like 239 people with Eisenhower fellows from 19 countries came from as far away as the United States. So I know that our fellows in Sri Lanka, along with our fellows in India and Pakistan, are talking about doing another one of those in the next year or so. So that's another opportunity that we would like to explore further with your colleagues here.
Thank you, George. I think that brings us to a close. It was wonderful chatting to you. And the intention was to give the folks here in this country a glimpse of what Eisenhower Fellowship is about. You as the president of Eisenhower Fellowship, I as a fellow who's benefited tremendously. And I must say, our fellows are from all different groups of society, all different political parties here in this country currently. And it has nothing to do with, like you very correctly said, this is a non-partisan, not-for-profit entity. I encourage people to read up, and once the call for applications go out, you can apply or go directly to efworld.org. So once again, thank you, George.
Well, thank you so much. Once you're an Eisenhower Fellow, you're part of a global family, and one of the requirements is you have to stay engaged with us for the rest of your life, as you have, and I deeply appreciate your engagement. I'm honored to be your colleague.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks, George.